Bibles this morning, please, and turn to Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11. I'm going to warn you ahead of time that I'm going to get to a point in this where I'm going to ask you for a response, and I will actually want you to respond. It's not rhetorical. And I will wait till I get one. It doesn't have to be right. It just has to be a response, all right? And so I'm just warning you that when I get there and I say, hey, so what do you think? I'm actually wanting to know. I'm not kidding. What does That's a loaded question, isn't it? What does a good Christian look like? In Hebrews, we're studying Hebrews for the past almost a year now at home. And we're in Hebrews 11. And one of the things that really struck me, again, it isn't like I didn't know it the other 100 times that I read Hebrews in my life, but it struck me again that God says very clearly and indisputably that without faith, it is what? Impossible to please Him. Now, we know that that's true when it comes to becoming a believer in Jesus Christ. You cannot become a true son of God, a true child of God, without faith in the finished work of Christ. We know that. But He's talking in Hebrews to believers, right? And He's saying, now let me tell you straight up, I know you want to please Me. If you're a child of God, you want to please Him, don't you? I mean, you do. We don't always please Him. We don't always want to please Him in the moment, or we would never sin. But we always, as in our lifespan, as the characterization of our heart and life, you want to please Him. You do. I mean, who in the room, this is just for a quickie, who in the room does not want to hear, well done, thou good and faithful servant? Like, yeah, that would really stink if you heard that at the end. I'd rather hear, what are you doing here? Obviously, that's not true. We all want to please Him. And so what He's telling us in a very important and sobering way is, if you do not learn what it is to live by faith, you can't please Me. It's impossible. You will not please Me. It's interesting, later on, actually just yesterday, Sunday, we were studying a little bit later in the chapter than we're going to look at this morning. And at the end of God speaking about what Abraham, and He speaks about these all died in faith, not having received the promises, it goes on and on. And then it makes this statement. I remember when this statement grabbed me, I was a senior in high school, and I don't know, I was reading my Bible, and it grabbed me, and it's never lost my attention. Because at the end of paragraph, He says, therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God. So on Sunday, the premise was, is God proud of you? Wouldn't that be great if He was? I mean, wouldn't that be great if when you came to mind, it was like, hey, yeah, Tim, yeah, love that guy. He's a good guy. Put your name in there. I know Tim doesn't work for you, except for a few of you. Okay, but hey, your name comes to God's mind. And it goes, and He goes, yeah, love that girl. She really pleases Me. He really pleases Me. So, there's a tendency in all of our lives to think that to get to such a glorious state as pleasing God and Him being proud of me, that there's this elusive kind of holy grail characterization of a life that a few people that we tend not to like anyway may achieve, because they tend to be snooty, self-righteous, and superior, and overconfident. And all of us regular folks are just losers and can never get there. So we won't get there. They will get there because they're so good, and we'll just hate them for it. But it's interesting when you actually read what living by faith looks like. for real, from God's point of view, which happens to be the right one, right? So not your point of view, not your friend's point of view, not your hall leader's point of view, not even my point of view if I was your pastor, from God's point of view. And that's what I want to take just a few minutes for us to focus on this morning, because to me, I find it very encouraging. Now, I'm going to read a text, I'm going to read a couple things, and then I'm going to ask you to get involved here for a minute, all right? The text for this morning starts in verse 8. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to a place that he was to receive as an inheritance. And he went out, not knowing where he was going. By faith, he lived in a land of promise, as in a foreign land, living in tents with Isaac and Jacob, heirs with him of the same promise. For he was looking forward to a city that has foundations, whose designer and builder is God. By faith, Sarah herself received power to conceive, even when she was past the age, since she considered him faithful who had promised. Therefore, from one man and him, not a very nice thing to say about Abraham, him as good as dead, were born descendants. Supposed to be nice to old people. Okay? Not even supposed to call them old people. Mature, experienced, highly experienced people. Abraham was as good as dead. Were born descendants as many as the stars of heaven and as many as the innumerable grains of sand by the seashore. So clearly, as God writes in Hebrews and talks about living by faith, and he says, you can't please me without it, and if you live by faith, I'm proud to be called your God. He points to Abraham and Sarah as examples of people who live by faith, right? Abraham left his entire background, country, family, pack them up, and takes off to go to live in the land as a permanent visitor forever and ever and ever, and he did not know where he was going. And we hate it when we're men going anywhere and we're asked, do you know where you're going? And because we think we do. And poor Abraham, every time Sarah said, do you know where you're going? Abraham had to say, nah, I got no clue. But we're still going. And it was a very, very difficult thing. And so there's this great act of faith. He goes up there. We know Abraham's life, Sarah's life. Abraham's 100. Sarah's a bit less than 100. No way they can have children. Finally, Isaac is born. Yeah, this is great. These are great examples of faith. As a matter of fact, Paul in the book of Romans puts it this way. Just listen again. This is God through Paul describing how he looks at the life of Abraham and Sarah. In hope, this is Romans 4:18, he believed against hope that he should become the father of many nations, as he had been told, so shall your offspring be. He did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body, which was as good as dead, since he was about 100 years old, or when he considered the barrenness of Sarah's womb. No distrust made him waver concerning the promise of God, but he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, fully convinced that God was able to do what he promised. Okay, now, frankly, by this point, if I'm being honest, I'm thinking, wait a minute. Okay, Hebrews says, Abraham and Sarah lived by faith, went out, went to the new land through faith, were able to conceive seed and had Isaac, and that was great. And then Paul is saying, Abraham, he went out, he didn't waver, there was no staggering at the promises of God, he was strong in faith. Yay, good, great, wonderful, yay, Abraham. Okay, now, here's what I'm asking you to think. In anybody's mind, is there a like, okay, But what about? Is there any? Now this is where, like, maybe you could come up with an answer. Well, what about that little Hagar thing? What was that? I mean, seriously. So what was this thing? That was nothing. Okay, what was with him taking another wife and having a son against God's direction, will, and commands? Clearly not an act of faith, right? Clearly a problem for Abraham till this day, right? So it's like, wait, did like God forget that or something? What about that before that where okay, it says he went to this land and he stayed as a permanent visitor, but if you think back a little bit in Genesis, there was this time when there was a famine and he left and he went down. Where'd he go? Egypt. It's like, wait. What do you mean you stay? What was that little Egypt thing? Vacation? You go down to Egypt, you lie about your wife, you almost let your wife get married to Pharaoh. Well, what's with that? And then you get a little bit later after the Hagar little thing, and the angels come and they announce that within a year you're going to have that baby, and Sarah laughs. She cracks up. Now Abraham and Sarah were old, advanced in years. The way of women had ceased to be with Sarah. So Sarah laughed to herself, saying, after I am worn out and my Lord is old, shall I have pleasure? It's like, this is crazy. I mean, that's where Isaac gets his name, right? Laughter. Because Abraham had cracked up once. And this doesn't crack up as in this is funny. He's like, yeah, right. Give me a break. And Sarah not only laughed, then when the angel said, hey, why Sarah laugh? What did Sarah do? She lied right through her teeth. Oh, I didn't know. It wasn't me. So it's like, okay, now wait a minute here. God says that Abraham and Sarah pleased him. And he was proud to be called their God. Did he forget? Or perhaps is there a different way to understand that? I really do think, and I think for me one of the first times it became very, very clear was in Bible college. Now, I was in a Bible college 100,000 years ago. And you begin to hear a lot of preaching from a lot of different people. Some of them your roommates. Which was the worst preaching of all. That there is a profound confusion about what living by faith actually looks like. Living by faith is not fearless. We think if you're living by faith, you are one confident son of a gun. You're bulletproof. You're impervious. You are strong. You are mighty. You are an arrogant pain in the neck. Okay? But we think faith is fearlessness. Because you should never be afraid, because if you're trusting God, you would never be afraid. And let me say this to you. If you're not afraid, you have no reason to trust Him. And if you're not afraid, you are brain dead. Because you are thinking that you are enough. You are a bug heading towards the windshield of life saying, I can do this. Yeah, if do this is explode on the windshield, you can do that. Abraham got afraid every now and then. He did. Sarah was afraid. She was afraid to trust. Okay, because this is another time the angel is saying, you're going to have a baby. She's been wanting to have a baby for decades. And she had gotten her hopes up. And she was still waiting and waiting and waiting. And the waiting wasn't months. It wasn't years. It was decades of waiting. And when they say, okay, no, next year, she was afraid. Don't you ever get afraid to trust the promise again? Because you don't want to accuse God that He broke His promise, but you're pretty sure He hasn't kept it yet. Okay, don't raise your hand out so people could see it, but just raise your hand in your head. Because I can see it anyway. How many of you have a promise that you figure God made you? It's like in the book. And he hasn't made good on yet. And aren't you a little bit afraid that he might not? I frequently get asked, I don't know why, for whatever reason, hey, are you ever afraid? Did you ever get afraid? And I say, I live afraid. I mean, not under the covers kind of that way, or not under a rock kind of afraid, but yeah. If you have an accurate assessment of your abilities and what's facing you, you have good reason to be afraid. You are not enough. Contrary to Dr. Phil and Oprah Winfrey, you are not smart enough. You can't do anything. You can't be anything you want to be. Okay, look, if you could be anything you wanted to be, would you be what you are right now? Would you? There's like three people like, yes, I would. And none of us like you, whoever you just did that, okay? You would say, no, look, if I had a button that could change this, I would choose to look this way? What are you, am I brain dead? Of course I would. I might make you all bald. That might make it easier for me, but I wouldn't, like, choose this. Living by faith is not being fearless. Clearly, because Abraham and Sarah were afraid, right? Right? You with me? You alive? They were. Okay. And living by faith is not faultless. They did screw up. Big time. I mean, an extra son is like not a little misstep. Oh yeah, I got this little mistake. It's another wife and child. I'm sure, honey, I'm sure you'll be good with that. I made a little mistake last weekend. I have another wife and a boy. Just a little mistake. I mean, it was a big mess up, right? And God at no time approves of their wrong choices made in their fear. But still somehow, when God thinks on Abraham and Sarah, he says, I am proud to be called their God. Because living by faith is not fearless and it's not faultless. Fear is the normal and rational response to circumstances we can't control, and most circumstances we can't control. Fear, though not a sin in itself, is a root cause of many of our wrong choices. We know that the fear of man lays a snare, but whoever trusts in the Lord is safe. We know that in the parable of the stewards with the talents, you know, the five talents, two talents, one talent, that the reason that the wicked servant, the one that failed and displeased his master miserably, did so because he was afraid, and he made a decision based on fear. He says, so I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. So, if faith is living by faith, and if you don't live by faith, it is impossible. I don't care how many things you do. I don't care how many people you impress. If you don't come to terms in a day-to-day way with living by faith, it is impossible for you to please God. Impossible. Okay, so if living by faith doesn't mean I have to be without fear, which is a good thing, right? Because we have it. And living by faith doesn't mean I have to be without fault, or we'd all be done right now. Just quit and go home. Well, then what is it? What is it? When we look back in our text this morning, in the middle of all these descriptions, it says this, and let me find here, okay. By faith, verse 11, Sarah herself received power to conceive, even when she was past the age, since, because, here's the point, Here's the root cause that she is described as living by faith and then having her faith blessed with God's miraculous intervention in her life. Because she considered him faithful who had promised. Some of the best things in Scripture, some of the most important things in Scripture are not the most exciting things in Scripture. It's like that, so that was it. She considered him faithful who had promised. So that's all you got this morning, huh? Great. In that statement, what we learn is that living by faith is a choice. It's not a feeling. It's a choice. Literally, she did the math. She sat down. She made a choice. She looked at her circumstances. Here's the math that gets done in a living by faith choice. Okay, here's what I got. I got nothing. Here's what's demanded of me. I'm toast. I can't do it. Can't do it. On the other side, I have this command from God to obey, to do something. It's from him. It's from Christ to me. So what Sarah did was, okay, I'm going to trust what he said. It doesn't look good. The numbers are bad. It's humanly insane. Okay? I'm 750 years old, and I'm going to have a baby next year. Right. What's that baby going to look like? Holy cow. It'll come out at 600 years old. Whoa. You see, living by faith is a choice to obey him. Not because I'm not afraid, because I am afraid. But he said, and I trust him. See, living by faith is not a look. It's not a set of rules necessarily. There are commands of Scripture that we need to obey, clearly. It's not a personality, and it's not a skill or gift set. Living by faith is coming to know him in such a way that even though everybody else is saying this, if he says this, even though I happen to agree with what everybody else is saying, even though the way I see it is the way everybody else is saying it, he said this, I'm going with him. Because he's God. He's my Savior. I trust him. Living by faith is you in a personal relationship with Jesus Christ where you choose, even though you may be at the time completely paralyzed by fear, go with what he said, because he's him. It's Jesus. You know, in our personal friendships at times, not to that extent, but in a similar way, there are people that, well, there's people that you don't trust. Well, he said he would. It's like, yeah, you know him. He's not coming. But there's also somebody else in your life, probably, not perfectly, but similar, where it's like, okay, it looks bad, but he said or she said, and I know him, I know her, and it's looking bad, and it looks like he won't, and it looks like she never will, but she said she would. And all the argument says, it doesn't look like she is, but when you trust her, if you really know her, if you really know that guy, and you really do trust him, then what are you going to do? Are you going to go with what you think and feel and everybody's saying, or are you going to go with what that person said to you? Which one are you going to do if you really trust him? He said he'd come. He said he'd pick me up. He's going to be here. We're all leaving. Now, if this is a certain person, like, I'm leaving with you because I know he'll never come. He never comes. But if it's somebody who's always kept their word to you, what are you going to do? It's like you could say something now. Who are you going to trust? You going to go with the group or are you going to go with him? Give me the right answer, even if you don't believe it. Okay, no. You're going to go with him, right? I mean, if you really trusted him. If you really trusted him. And that's the point. When push came to shove, Abraham, he messed up a few times. He got better. I mean, by the end of his life, there's that Isaac thing and the offering on Mount Moriah. And man, that was stellar faith. But that didn't come overnight. That was built over many, many years of not being fearless and not being faultless, but making the decision, okay, I'm scared out of my mind, but I'm going to go with what he said because I trust him. I don't feel trust for him right now. What I feel is fear. What I feel is panic. What I feel is pressure. But he said, God said to do this. And I don't do it. Please understand when I say this. I don't do it because it's the rule to be a good person. I do it because he said. I don't do it because I'm committed to a code of life. I do it because he said. He said that will mess me up. He said if I go that way, it will mess me up. He said that. But, and I got lots of fears and I got lots of passions. But he said. So, I'm going to go with what he said. Living by faith in the middle of all your fears and pressures and passions is going with, I'll go with what he said. And because of that, living by faith is a choice, and a choice, it's a choice to trust him. And it's a choice that gives God the real and powerful opportunity to be glorified in your life. Because she did the math and went against the numbers and went with him, Sarah gave birth to Isaac in a most miraculous way. God gets the opportunity to do the most spectacular of his works, not in the lives of confident, well-manicured, well-prepped, well-spoken, well-trained, completely self-reliant people who quote Scripture. God doesn't do great work there. That guy does great work there. That girl does great work. Well, so you live that way, you live by what you think and what you can do and what your friends think, and then you know what you get to do for the rest of your life? You get to see, you get to experience what you can do. You get to see what you can do for the rest of your life. If I will choose, even though I'm afraid, just to do what he said, I will get to spend the rest of my life seeing what he can do. And he can make poor old Abraham, who twice in Scripture is called as good as dead, to become the father of many nations. I'm in a Bible study on a regular basis, and we're going through Mark with a bunch of newer believers, and I'm reminded how frequently Jesus commanded people who had no power to do what he was commanding them to do something. So he said to the, remember this, he went to Sunday school, so when they let him down through the ceiling and he's laying there in front of Christ. We all have that picture in our head. Okay, I said this in my Bible study, but they didn't grow up in church, so they know nothing of our weird Christian culture. Okay, so I mentioned something, and everybody in the room, there's like 20 people, and they all laughed me to scorn. Okay. Probably the only people in the room will be over 100. How many of you remember flannel graph? All right. I said, flannel graph. They said, what? I said, you know, it's like these things. what? It's like, so, but I remember flannel graph, where they're hanging the guy down in front of Jesus on the bed. It was cool, high-tech stuff 600 years ago. But Jesus looks at the guy on the bed and he says, get up. But think about that. Just think about that. Okay, yeah, he gets up. Yeah, okay, wait a minute. He tells the guy who can't walk, get up. A couple chapters later, he tells the guy whose hand's withered, stick it out. Okay, think about that for a second. It's like, if I could get up, wouldn't I have come in there on my legs? Wouldn't I have walked in there? And you're telling me to do something I cannot do. How can I do what I cannot do? Duh. How can I do what I cannot do? Sarah decided. She considered. She came to a conclusion that even though she had no ability to conceive a child, she would believe what he said. Because it's him. Because it's Christ. And so she did what she could not do. And God was glorified, displayed to the world for time and eternity. That's why God says, Sarah, yeah, I know she laughed. And actually, that Hagar thing, that was Sarah's idea. What was she thinking? But when God thinks of Sarah and writes of her in God's Word, he says, I'm proud to be Sarah's God. Because even though she was afraid, and even though she screwed up, she decided, I'll just do what he said, even though I can't do it. I can't do it. But he said it. So that's the way we're going to go. Because I'm going to choose to trust him. Not trust the Christian way. Not live the Christian life. Not serve the Christian cause. Not take over the world for Jesus. I'm going to just trust him. See, you can do that. Not without fear and not without faults, but you can do that. Every one of us who have been saved by faith can live by faith. It's wonderful. It's terrifying. It makes you sail. It's humiliating. It's the most scary ride you've ever been on in all your stinking life. Take all the scary rides in the world and put them into one. It's worse than that, and it's better than that. But at the end of that life, in the middle of that life, and at the end of that life, you and all those that see that life will see not what you could do. Sorry, that's not impressive. You'll get to see what God can do. Wouldn't that be something? Let's pray. Father, I certainly thank you that you don't require fearlessness, or I'm out. I thank you that you don't require faultlessness, or I'm out. I've already screwed up big time. I thank you that even though I have laughed, like Sarah laughed, that you allow me to choose day by day to trust you. Even though I'd rather not, I'd rather go my own way, but I know when I do the math that you're the one I must trust. You are reliable. You are Christ. You are the one and only. And Lord, I rejoice in the truth that when we live by faith, you do stuff that only you can do in and through our lives, for which we can take no credit and only give you glory. I pray that you'd encourage the heart of each of these young people. We get a lot of different pictures about what you're expecting of us out of life, and they're confusing and conflicting. And sometimes they raise us up in artificial, arrogant pride, and sometimes they just discourage us like we have no hope. And the truth isn't found in those extremes. I pray you'd help each young person in the room to know that it's impossible for them to please you without faith. But you can be like Abraham and Sarah and still be living by faith. I pray you'd encourage them.